Good morning everyone, myself Dr. Sejal Gamit, Assistant Professor in Pathology. Today I am going to discuss about cell adaptations and pathological calcification. Competencies of my today's lectures are describe and discuss cellular adaptation, hypertrophy, hyperplasia, atrophy, metaplasia and dysplasia, as well as describe and discuss pathologic calcification. At the end of the lecture, you are able to describe and discuss hypertrophy, hyperplasia, atrophy, metaplasia and dysplasia, as well as able to describe and discuss type of pathologic calcification. As we have already discussed in our previous lecture, that the cells normally remain in a steady state, that is called homeostasis, but whenever the cell is exposed to stress or noxious stimuli, a sequence of events follows that is termed as adaptation, followed by cell injury and cell death. This figure explains the overview of cell injury. The cells normally remain in a steady state, that is called homeostasis. Whenever the cell is exposed to stress and increased demand, the cells try to meet increased demand by undergoing adaptation. But if the limit of adaptive responses are exceeded, or if the cells are exposed to injurious agent, a sequence of events follow that is termed as cell injury. If the stimulus is mild, the injury is reversible. But if the stimulus persists for a longer duration, it may cause irreversible cell injury in the form of cell death, either by necrosis or apoptosis. Today, we are particularly focusing on adaptation. So, what is adaptation? Adaptation are reversible functional and structural response to more severe physiological stress and pathological stimuli, during which new but altered steady state are achieved, allowing the cells to survive and continue to function. Means, whenever the cell is exposed to any form of stress or pathological stimuli, cells try to adapt the situation by undergoing adaptation. Why the cells achieve this new state? The cell achieve this new state to escape from the cell injury and so able to survive and continue to function. Remember, adaptation are reversible changes. These reversible changes occur either in the number of the cell, size of the cells, metabolic activity or function of the cells. Depending on this, there are five types of cellular adaptation that include hypertrophy, hyperplasia, atrophy, metaplasia and dysplasia. These adaptive changes either may be physiological or pathological. So what is physiological adaptation? Physiological adaptation usually represent response of the cells to normal stimulus by hormone or endogenous chemical mediators. Pathological adaptations are responses to stress that allow cells to modulate the structure and function and thus escape injury. So, pathological adaptations are always pathological. Let us describe various types of cellular adaptation. First is hypertrophy. Hypertrophy is an increase in the size of the cell, resulting in increase in size of the organ. In hypertrophy, there are no new cells, just a bigger cell that contain increased amount of structural protein and organelles. Hypertrophy occurs in a cell which have a limited capacity to divide. In our body, striated muscle of skeletal muscle and heart have a limited capacity to divide. So whenever there is increased workload, they are undergoing hypertrophy to accommodate the demand. Hypertrophy can be physiological and pathological. So what is the example of physiological hypertrophy? The massive physiological enlargement of uterus during pregnancy occurs as a consequence of hormone-induced, that is estrogen-stimulated, smooth muscle hypertrophy and smooth muscle hyperplasia. In this figure, you can easily see that is hypertrophied uterus as compared to the normal uterus, And in the right side, you can see normal smooth muscle as compared to the hyperplasia of the smooth muscle, increase in size of the smooth muscle, which is due to hormonal stimulation. Hypertrophy may be pathological. Pathological hypertrophy are increasing are usually in response to increased demand. The striated muscle in the both skeletal muscle and heart can undergo only hypertrophy. Those adult muscle have a limited capacity to divide. In this figure, you can see normal heart, as well as on the left side you can see concentric hypertrophied heart, and on the right side you can see dilated heart. In the heart, the stimulus for hypertrophy is usually chronic hemodynamic overload resulting either from the hypertension, which causes concentric hypertrophy, or due to faulty valve, which may cause dilated heart. In both tissue types, the muscle cells synthesize more protein and more number of myofilament, which increases amount of force each myocyte can generate, and thus increases strength and work capacity of a muscle as a whole. This figure explains the pathological cellular hypertrophy. In the first figure, you can see normal myocardial fiber, normal myocyte, while on the hypertrophied myocyte, you can easily see there is increase in the size of the myocyte as well as the increase in size of nucleus as well. Why there is hypertrophy in the heart? Hypertrophy usually result in the synthesis of more proteins and myofilament per cell, which increases force generated with each contraction, enabling the cells to meet increased work demand. There may also be a switch of contractile protein from adult to fetal or neonatal form. Sometimes whenever there is hypertrophy, there is switching in the contractile protein from adult to fetal type. For example, during muscle hypertrophy, the alpha myosin heavy chain is replaced by beta form of myosin heavy chain, which produces slow but more energetical economical contraction. Whatever the exact mechanism of hypertrophy, a limit is reached beyond which the enlargement of muscle mass can no longer compensate for the increased burden. When this happens in the heart in the form of progressive cell injury, several degenerative changes take place in the myocardial fiber, of which the most important changes are fragmentation and loss of myofibrillar contractile element. The net result of these changes is ventricular dilatation and ultimately cardiac failure, that is cell death, a sequence of events that illustrates how an adaptation to stress, that is hypertrophy, can progress to functionally significant cell injury if stress is not removed. Means how the hypertrophy can progress to cardiac failure. Another example of hypertrophy are hypertrophy of smooth muscle that include pyloric stenosis, cardiac achalasia, muscular arteries in the hypertension, and compensatory hypertrophy. The example are when the contralateral organ is removed, as in case of nephrectomy. Now let us discuss hyperplasia. What is hyperplasia? It takes place if the tissue contains cell population capable of replication. It may occur concurrently with hypertrophy and often in response to stem stimuli. So basically, it is increase in number of cells. It is again of two types, either physiological or pathological. The two types of physiological hyperplasia are hormonal hyperplasia and compensatory hyperplasia. So what is hormonal hyperplasia? Hormonal hyperplasia generally increases the functional capacity of a tissue when needed. The most common example are proliferation of glandular epithelium of female breast at puberty and during pregnancy, as well as hyperplasia of pregnant uterus. And compensatory hyperplasia which increases tissue mass after damage or partial resection. One of the example is when the part of liver is resected, mitotic activity in the remaining cell of the hepatocytes begins as early as 12 hours later, eventually restoring the liver to its normal weight. The stimuli for hyperplasia in this setting are polypeptide growth factor produced by uninjured hepatocytes as well as normal parenchymal cell in the liver. After restoration of liver mass, cell proliferation is turned off by various growth factors. Another example for compensatory hyperplasia is marrow hyperplasia, that is bone marrow hyperplasia following rapid blood loss in hemolysis and blood donation. Pathological hyperplasia are caused by excessive hormonal growth factor stimuli. We all know that the uterine epithelial proliferation, that is normally regulated by stimulation through pituitary hormone and ovarian estrogen and inhibited by progesterone. However, a disturbance between estrogen and progesterone causes endometrial hyperplasia, which is a common cause of abnormal menstrual bleeding. Benign prostatic hyperplasia in old age, which also occur as a hormonal stimulation by androgen. And hyperplasia also is an important response of connective tissue cells in wound healing, in which proliferating connective tissue like fibroblast and blood vessels aid in repair. In this process, growth factors are produced by the WBC responding to the injury and by cell in the extracellular matrix, which increases the synthesis of connective tissue. In this figure, you can see normal endometrium. As compared to the normal endometrium, there is increase in the number of cells, which you can easily see in the example of simple hyperplasia and complex hyperplasia. There is increased gland to stroma ratio. An important point is that in all of this situation, the hyperplastic process remains controlled. If the signal that initiate it abate, the hyperplasia disappear. In many cases, pathological hyperplasia constitute a fertile soil in which cancer may eventually arise. For example, patients with hyperplasia of endometrium are at increased risk of developing endometrial cancer. Atrophy. What is atrophy? It is shrinkage in size of cell by the loss of cell substance, is known as atrophy. When a sufficient number of cells are involved, the entire tissue or organ diminishes in size, become atrophic. Although atrophic cells may have diminished function, they are not dead. Causes of atrophy. Physiological atrophy example are atrophy of thymus, lymphoid tissue, brain with aging, atrophy of cornea after menopause. Normally, notochord and thyroglossal duct undergo atrophy during fetal development. The uterus decrease in size shortly after parturition is also a form of physiological atrophy. And the example of pathological atrophy are starvation atrophy, ischemic atrophy, disuse atrophy. Means whenever the organ remain disused for a longer duration, it may undergo disuse atrophy. Endocrine atrophy. The example is whenever there is loss of estrogen stimulation after menopause, result in physiological atrophy of endometrium as well as breast. Pressor atrophy, tissue compression due to tumor. An enlarging brain tumor or any form of tumor can cause atrophy in the surrounding involved tissue, as well as development and idiopathic atrophy. Here you can see brain atrophy. In the right side, you can easily see that there is narrowing of gyri and widening of sulci as compared to the normal brain. Here is the example of testicular atrophy. In the first figure, you can see seminiferous tubules with the cells, while on the right side, you can easily see that there is thickening of the basement membrane as well as increase in the Leydig cells, interstitial Leydig cells. The mechanism of atrophy consists of a combination of either due to decreased protein synthesis or increased protein degradation. Protein synthesis is decreased because of reduced metabolic activity. The degradation of the cellular protein occurs mainly by the ubiquitin proteasome pathway. Nutritional deficiency and disuse may activate ubiquitin ligase, which attach multiple copies of small peptide ubiquitin to cellular protein and target them for degradation in the proteasome. In many situations, atrophy is also accompanied by increased autophagy, which results in increase in number of autophagic vacuoles. Autophagy is a cell routine, is the process in which starved cells eat its own component in attempt to survive. These autophagic vacuoles are membrane-bound vacuoles that contain fragment of the cell component. The vacuole ultimately fuses with the lysosome, and their contents are digested by the lysosomal enzyme. Some of these debris within the autophagic vacuoles may resist digestion and persist as a membrane-bound residual body. This figure explains the ubiquitin bind with the protein, and this entire protein goes to the ubiquitin proteasome pathway, which causes degradation of protein. Metaplasia. Metaplasia is a reversible change in which one adult type, either epithelial or mesenchymal, is replaced by another adult cell type. In this type of cellular adaptation, a cell type sensitive to a particular stress is replaced by another cell type better able to withstand the adverse environment. The most common example of epithelial metaplasia is squamous change that occurs in the respiratory epithelium of habitual cigarette smokers. Normally, the respiratory tract aligned by ciliated columnar epithelium. The rux, which is replaced by stratified squamous epithelium in smoker. The stratified squamous epithelium may be able to survive the noxious chemical in cigarette smoke that the more fragile specialized epithelium would not tolerate. Although metaplastic squamous epithelium has survival advantage, important prototype mechanism of ciliated columnar epithelium, such as mucus secretion and ciliary clearance of particulate matter, are lost. Thus, epithelial metaplasia is therefore a double-edged sword. Moreover, the influence that is induced metaplastic change, if persistent, may predispose to malignant transformation of the epithelium. In fact, squamous metaplasia of respiratory epithelium often coexist with lung cancer composed of malignant squamous cells. This example, you can see the respiratory tract is lined by normal columnar epithelium, that is pseudostratified columnar sinuated epithelium. But due to the cigarette smoking, there is a metaplastic change in which columnar epithelium is replaced by squamous epithelium, that is called squamous metaplasia, which may be the cause for development of squamous cell carcinoma if the stimulus is not removed. Metaplasia in the esophagus. In chronic gastric reflux, the normal stratified squamous epithelium of lower esophagus may undergo metaplastic transformation to gastric or intestinal type of columnar epithelium. In the first figure, you can see the squamous epithelium of the esophagus, while on the right side you can see in which there is gastric type mucosa above the GI junction. Note that the columnar epithelium to the left and squamous epithelium at the right. Here the squamous epithelium is replaced by intestinal type of mucosa, that is also called as Barrett's esophagus. It is due to the continuous gastric reflux. Metaplasia may also occur in the mesenchymal cell, but in this situation There is formation of cartilage, bone or adipose tissue in tissue that normally do not contain this element. The most common example is the bone formation in soft tissue, particularly in the foci of cell injury. The example is myositis ossification, in which there is bone formation in the muscle following injury. Dysplasia. It is a disorder cellular development, often preceded or accompanied by metaplasia or hyperplasia, so also referred as atypical hyperplasia, mostly occur in the epithelial cells. Mild to moderate dysplastic changes are reversible if the stimulus is removed. If the stimulus persists, it may progress to severe grade or carcinoma in situ and invasive carcinoma. Morphological features of dysplasia are increase in number of layers of epithelial cell, loss of basal polarity, pleomorphism, nuclear hyperplasia, and mitosis increased. Here you can see the normal cervical epithelium, while there are certain dysplastic changes that take place in the cervix that include, there is in the CIN1 there is dysplasia in the basal layer. You can easily see there is nuclear hyperchromasia as well as loss of basal polarity, while in the CIN2 you can easily see there is more nuclear hyperplasia as well as increase in the mitosis that is reaching up to the 2/3 of epithelium. While in the CIN3, you can see there is entire thickness dysplasia as well as increase in the mitosis, which is reaching up to superficial layer. This CIN3 is also called in situ carcinoma because it is limited by the basement membrane, but whenever the basement membrane is ruptured, it may cause invasive SCC. Now let us discuss about the pathological calcification. What is pathological calcification? It is the abnormal deposition of salt together with some smaller amount of iron, magnesium and other minerals. Two types of pathological calcification are dystrophic and metastatic calcification. What is dystrophic calcification? When the deposition of calcium occurs in dead and dying tissue, it is called dystrophic calcification. It occurs in the absence of derangement of calcium metabolism, means there is normal serum calcium level. Dystrophic calcification is encountered in the area of necrosis of any type. It is virtually inevitable in the atheroma of advanced atherosclerosis associated with intimal injury in the aorta and large arteries, are characterized by accumulation of lipid. Although dystrophic calcification may be an incidental finding indicating insignificant past cell injury, it may also be a cause of organ dysfunction. For example, calcification can occur in the aging or damaged valve, resulting in severely compromised valvular motion. Dystrophic calcification of the aortic valve is an important cause of aortic stenosis in the elderly patient. In this figure, you can easily see the aortic valve and the whitish color calcification on the leaflet, which may eventually be the cause for aortic stenosis. Metastatic calcification. The deposition of calcium salt in normal tissue is known as metastatic calcification and is almost always secondary to some derangement in the calcium metabolism, means always there is a hypercalcemia. The major causes of hypercalcemia are increased secretion of parathyroid hormone, either due to primary parathyroid tumor or production of parathyroid hormone related protein by the other malignant tumor. The mechanism of action of parathyroid hormone is that it increases the absorption of calcium. That's why it causes hypercalcemia. Another example is the destruction of bone due to effect of accelerated turnover either due to the Paget's disease, immobilization, or due to presence of tumors like bone catabolism is associated with multiple myeloma, leukemia, and skeletal metastasis. Vitamin D related disorder, including vitamin D intoxication and sarcoidosis, in which macrophage activate a vitamin D precursor which increases calcium absorption. And final cause is the renal failure, in which phosphate retention lead to secondary hyperparathyroidism. Gross of pathological calcification, regardless of the site, calcium salt are seen on cross examination as fine white granules or clumps, often felt as a gritty deposits. Dystrophic calcification is common in area of caseous necrosis and tuberculosis, as well as in damaged heart valve. Metastatic calcification can occur widely throughout the body, but principally affect the interstitial tissue of vasculature, kidney, lung, and gastric mucosa. Microscopically, calcification appears as intracellular or extracellular basophilic deposition. Over time, heterotrophic bond may be formed in the focus of calcification. This figure shows the dystrophic calcification in the artery. There is basophilic deposit in the media of the artery. And this figure demonstrates metastatic calcification in the lung of patient with a high serum calcium level. You can see the basophilic deposited in the alveolar wall. These are my references. Thank you.